Before I start this video, I have a very special announcement to make. Last time I made numerous digs at the fact that Capcom has refused to translate Ace Attorney Investigations 2, and how that's just one of the poor business decisions they've made lately. Well, apparently somebody actually does care about this project besides me, because the translation site GBA Temp has been working on making a fan translation of Ace Attorney Investigations 2 into English. Now, so far, only the first two cases have been made available to play in beta form, but that's more than I think Capcom's gonna do with this game, so for those of you who actually care about this game along with me, here's what you can do. Download this game from GBA Temp from the link in the description, and report any errors you find while playing to them, whether it's text left untranslated, typos, and what have you. Normally, I wouldn't advocate what in technical terms is piracy, but I'm pretty sure this is the only way we're going to get Ace Attorney Investigations 2 in English now that the 3DS has come out. Unless there's some truth to that rumor I heard months ago about there being an official English patch, or Capcom saying they'll translate it if Dual Destinies does well in English, but like I said, that's not looking good. By the way, I wouldn't have heard about this patch if it weren't for the YouTube user whose footage I'm using for this retrospective, ZSlizer. He's done playthroughs of all of the Ace Attorney games so far, including Gyakuten Kenji 2, the Japanese version of Ace Attorney Investigations 2, and currently he's working on playing through the English beta, as well as remaking some of his older projects. Go check out his channel if you can't get hold of these games yourself and want to see some high-quality footage, not just of Ace Attorney games, but of a few other series you might recognize. But now, on with the show. They say that it's a defense attorney's job to believe in their client. That no matter what happens, knowing that your client is innocent will allow you to pursue the truth. But sometimes, it's just not that easy. You know, I don't hate Case Closed. Or at least, I didn't at first. The premise was unique, the main characters were likable, and it promised an entertaining mystery with each episode. But the thing is, somewhere along the line, the story seemed to lose its focus and just became an excuse to show murder mystery after murder mystery, most of which got less creative as the series continued. There was less and less development with the organization that shrunk Shinichi as the manga continued, and hey, as long as the writer could keep making money, he didn't need to develop it. I would eventually grow to dislike this series as a result, and I know that there are some shows that have ran for an incredibly long time besides Case Closed, but I'm sorry, I just didn't have the same attachment to those shows that I previously had to Case Closed. What I'm getting at here is, a series can't just devolve into the same thing over and over again, or the audience is going to lose interest. So the question is, could Phoenix Wright Ace Attorney Justice for All keep my interest while still continuing the story of the first game? Well, of course it could. Would I be making this retrospective otherwise? But admittedly, I think some people were skeptical when they saw the opening to the first case, which managed to cram two cliches into one. Phoenix has to defend a client in court, but the catch is, due to the murderer himself, he's given a case of amnesia and can't remember anything about the case, which results in a forced tutorial. How is it that Super Mario RPG, a game that came out decades earlier than this one, is one of the few games that gets that if you know about timed hits, you don't need to be told again every time you start a new save file? But as odd as this might sound, combining these two cliches actually sort of works. I mean, what better reason is there to go over game mechanics than if the main character himself has forgotten them? But I'm getting ahead of myself. The first case, The Lost Turnabout, starts off with Phoenix dreaming about a judge on Bald Mountain, I guess. Or maybe the judge is the Bald Mountain, haha. And I'm really not that far off, as the background music here is Toccata and Fugue, which I'm pretty sure some of you have heard, you just don't know it by name. This is apparently also Phoenix's ringtone. Oh, and yes, this is where the move from Ultimate Marvel vs. Capcom 3 comes from. Phoenix awakens, only to get clocked on the head by Michael Jackson and Prince's love child here, and soon finds himself with amnesia. Which isn't good, because it's at this point that Phoenix's client arrives, and the trial starts soon. Speaking of, Phoenix's client is a young police officer, who we later learn is named Maggie Bird, who I swear I've seen somewhere before. But I just can't put my finger on it. Of course, Maggie is understandably upset that Phoenix has amnesia right before trying to prove her innocence, but you know Phoenix, he's got this. Kind of. At least instead of, say, Von Karma, he's going up against, what was his name again? Payne? Yeah, I kind of forgot about him, but let's face it, so did you. So why does Maggie need Phoenix's help to begin with? Well, apparently she was accused of killing her quote-unquote lover, though Maggie insists they weren't that close yet, Dustin Prince, a fellow police officer. Again, haha. But an interesting turn of events is that when Gumshoe is called to the stand, since he is in charge of homicides after all, he looks almost sick to be accusing Maggie of murder, and Maggie says that Gumshoe was always watching out for her while she was training. Why, no, I don't ship Maggie and Gumshoe. Whatever gave you that? Wait, I already made that joke. As usual, things don't look too good for Maggie, since Dustin was apparently clutching the criminal's glasses as he was pushed off the wall that he died under, and coincidentally, Maggie happened to step on hers on the same day. However, as in the first case last time, the victim apparently wrote the culprit's name. Except he spelled Maggie wrong. And oh yeah, his neck was snapped at the time! Fortunately for Phoenix, Maggie actually happens to be a kind of fan of his, and she comes over to watch court proceedings when she's off duty, so she's able to mostly walk him through the trial with or without his memory. Oh, and you'll also notice that the exclamation points from earlier have been replaced with a straight-up HP bar. I kind of prefer it that way, if only for the sake of familiarity. I won't drag this out too much since, well, we already know who the murderer really was, so suffice to say it's soon proven that Dustin was left-handed, so he couldn't actually have written the message even if the name was spelled right, so Payne is left grasping at straws, as it should be. But the case isn't quite over yet, as Payne says he has another witness, and I think you already know who it is. But before that, a familiar face returns. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, Maya has returned. And she's got decisive evidence with her. See, apparently the phone Phoenix had earlier wasn't actually his, but rather a phone that Maggie found in the park while on a date with Dustin, and on his birthday, no less, before she was sent to the place where Dustin would ultimately die by the phone's owner. And apparently the phone contains the numbers of several con artists that are part of a gang that have been causing trouble in the city recently. Prince Jackson takes the stand and, okay, his name's actually Wellington. As in, by the time this trial is over, you'll want to shove a Wellington boot down his throat. Seriously, this guy is so defensive and pedantic, and he talks so much! In fact, are we sure his grandmother doesn't work for Global Studios? So to make it a long and very annoying story short, it's soon revealed that Wellington lost his glasses and his cell phone shortly before the crime, so he couldn't have witnessed Maggie committing the crime. But when Phoenix asks where Wellington's cell phone is now, he produces one. But it turns out that, thankfully, he and Phoenix have the same kind of phone. So he actually grabbed the wrong one when he conked him on the head earlier. And since the glasses under Dustin's body are actually Wellington's, it's also a pretty safe bet that he murdered Dustin, too. But why? Well, as it turns out, the list of phone numbers of con artists proves that Wellington was a member of said group. And because Officer Prince happened to be in uniform when he came to reclaim his phone from Maggie, he thought that they'd already scanned the phone for information and Maggie came with a police escort, not knowing they were dating or that Maggie was an officer herself. And Phoenix ultimately ends up proving that Wellington took the wrong phone by having Maya call his own phone number. The trial ends with Phoenix remembering everything, and getting his cell phone back, and Maggie getting her not guilty verdict along with Wellington being arrested, though it really does suck that she lost her boyfriend. But if you're anything like me, one question remains. How did Phoenix and Maya reunite? After all, Maya was leaving to go train when we last saw her. Well, for that we have to go back 2 months earlier, to the second case in this game, aptly named Reunion and Turnabout. We get a very vague opening that shows footage of a car accident, but the narrator saying it was no accident, that she was drugged with sleeping pills, and that she was murdered, apparently by Maya. Yes, Maya's being accused of a crime she didn't commit. Sadly, that's become a recurring theme by now. And then we cut to a new client arriving at Phoenix's office, introducing himself as Dr. Turner Gray, a surgeon. Apparently, 14 of his patients were killed when a nurse mixed up the medication for them, and Dr. Gray was accused of malpractice. Because, to use his words, the nurse had the nerve to up and die before she offered an explanation for her mistake. How rude of her. Don't worry, it may seem like these events are completely random, but trust me, they're all connected. See, that event took place a year ago, and Dr. Gray needs someone to help prove his innocence, since after that case, his clinic isn't seeing as many patients. But the only way to do that is to get a testimony from the dead. To that end, he's decided to enlist Maya's help, but Maya wouldn't agree to the channeling unless she could see Phoenix again first. Phoenix and Maya, OTP. So Phoenix goes to Karain Village to supervise the channeling, and it turns out it was only 2 hours from LA by train. Yeah, that kinda undercuts that sad goodbye from the last game. Anyway, upon getting to Karain Village, Phoenix reunites with Maya, but not before running into a strange little girl who runs away when he tries to talk to her. Apparently this girl is Pearl Fay, Maya's cousin. According to Maya, she's also a child prodigy when it comes to spirit channeling, but she's very wary of strangers since her mother drilled it into her head that she can't leave the village because of her aforementioned power. Anyway, after speaking with Maya, she returns to Fay Manor to begin the channeling, with Phoenix following behind. Dr. Gray says that while Maya's channeling the deceased nurse, he wants to get her to sign a confession that she killed the patients, not him. Going inside the channeling room, Phoenix meets Maya's Aunt Morgan and BAH! Really? Seriously, with that hair? Jeez, I've heard of having your hair in a bun, but that must be a whole loaf. Okay, moving on. And we soon find out why she's got such a temper. Morgan and her daughter Pearl are actually members of the branch family of the Fays, which basically means that even if they have strong spiritual power, Maya's family are still the true heirs to the Karain channeling technique, both being daughters of the former master, Misty Fay. On top of that, the power actually seems to have skipped out on Morgan somehow, even though her daughter's spiritual power is incredibly strong for her age. However, it seems she's actually done her best to keep her daughter away from the rest of the world to preserve that power, which is why she's so wary of strangers. Huh. Phoenix is also informed that only the client and the medium can be in the room while the channeling is being performed, and while it's happening, the big doors in front are locked. We also later learn that there's only one key. A trip out to the garden reveals someone sleeping in a spare room off to the side, and surprisingly, Lotta Hart. She's here for the channeling as well, since she's still trying to make a living as a paranormal photographer. Poor girl, she doesn't even know she's not allowed in. Dr. Gray and Maya enter the channeling chamber as planned, and the others wait outside, only to hear the sound of gunshots! Phoenix, without even hesitating, breaks the fucking door down to save Maya. Now you're a man! A mountie, mountie, mountie! But the euphoria quickly fades as they enter the room to find Dr. Gray murdered, and Maya's clothes stained with blood, claiming that he murdered her, so she killed him too. With the situation desperate, there's nothing Phoenix can do but go and report the situation to the police. After Lotta takes some photographs, well, at least she's a good journalist, the obvious soon becomes apparent. Even if Maya was channeling someone who technically did the murdering, it looks like she was the one who pulled the trigger, so she's the only one they can arrest. We also get some information about Dr. Gray. Apparently, even if he was a great surgeon, he had a bad personality, really controlling and hard to work for. I can't really make jokes at this. It's a legitimately tense situation. Not even seeing Gumshoe again manages to help the mood. So Phoenix, with nothing else to do, decides to question more people there and, wait, yeah, there was someone sleeping earlier, who turns out to be a Valley Girl version of the Wendy's mascot? Actually, this is Eenie Meenie. No doubt a descendant of Miney Moe. Apparently she's in occult studies at the local university, and she's the one who told Dr. Gray about Karain Village. But I'm sure she's too much of an airhead to have any ulterior motives, right? Well, further questioning just makes her deny that she knows Dr. Gray, even though she said she knew him a few minutes ago. On his way back to the channeling chamber, Phoenix runs into Pearl again, who for some reason has the key with her. Anyway, Phoenix starts talking to Gumshoe, and we learn that apparently Dr. Gray wasn't just shot, someone stabbed him with a knife first. Overkill much? Phoenix soon realizes that the pictures Lotta took might hold some extra clues, but before he can ask her about them, she runs off. Spending the night at Fay Manor, Phoenix arrives at the detention center to question Maya the next day, and understandably, Maya's pretty upset. She feels that her power might have been too weak to contain the spirit, so she couldn't stop her body from shooting Dr. Gray. And unfortunately, Maya loses consciousness when a spirit comes into her body, so she doesn't know what happened. But she did remember having a dream of being dead and buried in the ground. Maya is still scared and upset from the experience, but Phoenix knows one thing. He's still defending her, regardless of how open and shut the case seems.
I'm not crying. I just have something in my eye.
But before Phoenix goes, Maya has something to give him. Some kind of jewel like the one she has on her necklace called a Magatama, with instructions for Phoenix to give it to Pearl and that she'll lend him her spiritual powers, whatever that means. And I gotta say, for taking 2 hours to get to by train, Phoenix is making pretty good time going back and forth to Karain Village. He doesn't find Pearl and he can't get anywhere with Annie, but it's pretty clear that she's hiding something. Questioning Morgan doesn't help much either, but apparently the folding screen in back is actually covered in sacred writings. And along with a sacred urn somewhere else in the village, they're both precious artifacts. Examining the screen itself, however, reveals a bullet hole? Huh. Well, walking in the garden, Phoenix manages to run into Pearl, and showing her the Magatama makes her cry. Oh crap, why do I get the feeling this is going to end like that one episode of Timon and Pumbaa?
I warned you! What would happen if my baby Earl got scratched?!
However, Pearl suddenly recognizes Phoenix and she thinks he's Maya's special someone. I don't like where this is going. But she agrees to help Phoenix out because she can tell he's a good person and she wants to be like Maya when she grows up. Aww. But despite not knowing what a lawyer is, being a sheltered child and all, Pearl not only gives Phoenix the key she was carrying, but she also charges up the Magatama with spiritual energy. She tags along with Phoenix for a while, and I have to admit, the idea of little Pearl walking along with Nick in a suit is a pretty cute image. Talking to Gumshoe doesn't really change much, other than trying to get Pearl to open up to him by showing her his pistol, which sounds a lot worse than it is when you say it out loud. Gumshoe claims he had an article from a newspaper on Dr. Gray, but seems to have lost it. However, he's got an even worse piece of news for Phoenix. Apparently, the prosecutor he'll be facing in court tomorrow is... Von Karma? Hold on a second, I thought he went to jail. Well, he did. Apparently, this Von Karma is actually his successor. I mean, it's not like this court system would ever use a prosecutor who was already serving jail time. Just you wait. His successor apparently became a prosecutor at the age of 13, but was born and raised in Germany, so you know they've got to be hardcore. Given how Von Karma is apparently Satan, there are so many jokes about Nazi devils I could make that it's not even funny. Literally, so in the name of good taste, I won't. Now here's our first guy dang it moment. You actually have to go all the way back to Phoenix's office and get the newspaper Dr. Gray brought with him when he first entered the office, and that finally helps Gumshoe find the article about the accident. But now it's time to question Annie again, and to introduce a new gameplay mechanic. Yeah, you didn't think there was going to be one of those, did ya? When Phoenix has the charged up Magatama, it allows him to see things that normally only spirit mediums could see. Well, mostly pertaining to people keeping secrets. If someone has a secret they're trying to hide, these locks, called psyche locks or psych locks, I'm not really sure how they're pronounced, appear. And the more they want to keep the secret, the more locks you'll see. There's only one on Eni for now, but trust me, there'll be many more later. Unfortunately, however, Phoenix doesn't have a keyblade with the power to unlock people's hearts, though again, that's a pretty awesome image. So how do you unlock them? Well, the same way any lawyer would, with evidence. Yes, presenting the right piece of evidence will break the lock, and the person in question will have no choice but to tell you what they know in the face of said evidence. But be careful. Presenting the wrong piece of evidence, just like in court, will hurt you. Presenting the second newspaper article to Annie reveals that the victim in the accident was Annie's sister, Mimi, a nurse at Dr. Gray's clinic, which is of course how she knew him. However, Annie believes that the accident happened as a result of Mimi being pushed too hard by Dr. Gray's controlling ways, along with the death of the 14 patients. It's interesting information, but we really don't have anything to help Maya out yet. So Phoenix, not knowing what else to do, returns to the detention center, only to find a surprise. Yeah, Maya's already channeled Mia while he was gone, and man, she couldn't have picked a better time to show up. After Phoenix tells her what happened, Mia says it's possible Maya's been set up, mostly because mediums, as Maya told us earlier, let themselves go completely when channeling, so they couldn't possibly have dreams. And on top of that, there's that key Pearl gave Phoenix, which makes no sense because Maya took it into the channeling chamber with her. But Mia's got one last surprise for Phoenix. When Phoenix wonders aloud who the real murderer is, suddenly psyche locks appear on Mia.
What a twist!
But there's no time to analyze them, and even if we could, we don't have the proper evidence yet, so we switch over to the next day in court. After reminiscing about how much of an asshole Von Karma was, suddenly Phoenix and Maya are interrupted by Pearl. Yeah, apparently her mother's supervising some trainees, so Pearl actually snuck out of the village and ran all the way to the courthouse, since she was worried about Maya and doesn't even know what a train is.
Damn.
Maya happens to bring up Edgeworth, but to everyone's surprise, Phoenix shushes her and tells her that Edgeworth's gone and he won't be coming back. Which is complete bullshit, since he gets his own games later on. But enough about that, it's time to meet the new prosecutor, Franziska Von Karma. Yes, people, this is Manfred Von Karma's daughter. I don't know what's more terrifying, the fact that he has a daughter who's out for revenge, or the fact that Von Karma actually reproduced. Also, true story. When I was in 8th grade and just getting into Phoenix Wright through online videos, we had a German exchange student named Franziska. I swear I'm not making that up. Though, to be fair, she was nothing like this Franziska. Very cold personality, has a very formal way of speaking, always calling Phoenix Mr. Phoenix Wright, or variations of the word fool. And oh yeah, she carries a whip that she can and does use in court. I know this game is supposed to be lampooning just how one-sided the Japanese court system was, but shouldn't she be charged with assault at least once? Anyway, much like her father, there's not much you can do in the beginning except press every statement. However, unlike her father, new pieces of evidence don't come to light from this. It's only after Phoenix refuses to change his plea from not guilty to justified self-defense, which would basically be confessing to a murder, that Franziska orders Gumshoe to present the other piece of evidence he had, Maya's bloody costume. But when Franziska tries to steer away from the evidence, Phoenix realizes that the costume has another piece of evidence in it, a bullet hole. And there's no powder burn to indicate the hole in the costume came from close range, so perhaps it might have come from somewhere else. And that hole in the folding screen Phoenix found earlier matches up to it. And since it's so low to the ground, the only time that could have happened was when Maya was sitting down, instead of getting ready to attack Dr. Gray. Taking the new evidence into light, Lotta gets called to the stand after the recess. So we finally get to see that photo and, crap, there doesn't seem to be anything we can present here. Time for a Deus Ex Mia. But this time, I could make a joke here, but really, giving a little girl D-cups kinda speaks for itself. Any joke that I made would probably be in really poor taste.
You boy! Boy!
Yeah, like that. Mia tells Phoenix that there's something he's missing, and he asks to question Lotta again, and surprisingly enough, Franziska actually allows this. Well, if only to prove that her testimony is perfect, but as Phoenix soon discovers, it actually isn't. Turns out, Lotta took a second picture, again with Lotta and missing pictures, which Franziska chose not to present because she didn't think it was important. Now, at first it looks like this is of no consequence, since, after all, Maya takes on the appearance of whoever she's channeling, the fact that she doesn't look like Maya here means nothing. Or does it? Yeah, the bullet hole Phoenix found isn't in the kimono on the second picture, which contradicts the evidence we've seen so far. Von Karma tries to say the police didn't tell her about the bullet hole, but Phoenix, and the audience, don't buy that for a second. Phoenix, seizing his chance, declares that this person can't be Maya Fey based on the missing bullet hole, and Franziska just loses her shit, whipping everybody in the court and practically having a nervous breakdown on the stand. But Phoenix then pulls out the key, literally in this case, stating that the channeling chamber key, being the only one of its kind, should have been with Maya as she locked herself in the room and was with Morgan until she was arrested, proving that if Pearl got it somehow, then Maya was somehow removed from the channeling chamber. So now, with both sides at an impasse, court is adjourned as Franziska rants about the flaws in her perfect case. Later, Phoenix takes Pearl back home, and it's then that he realizes he forgot to ask Pearl what she was doing at the time of the murder. He does, and Pearl, well, let's just say she's not a good liar. And the psyche locks aren't helping. Apparently, though, she is able to tell Phoenix where she found the key. and the incinerator. Okay, fine.
Suspicious.
Phoenix then goes back to the channeling chamber and catches Morgan in the middle of a, well, private moment.
Did you see anything?
No, sir. I didn't see you playing with your dolls again.
Good!
We'll get back to that later, but while we don't learn anything new about the case from Morgan, she does tell Phoenix that Misty Faye actually disappeared about 17 years ago. Well, I'm pretty sure that any fiction fans know that if they never found the body, she'll be returning later. And since this is a family of spirit mediums, maybe that stigma won't even apply. Also, apparently if she's disappeared from the village for over 20 years, she'll be considered dead, and ownership of the Karain channeling technique will fall to a new master. Possibly in Morgan's family. Wait, a woman with supernatural powers who's jealous of another person with supernatural powers in a position of authority? And her name's Morgan Fay? Gah! Sorry, that reference was so obvious it physically hurt me. However, walking into the garden, Phoenix runs into Innie throwing something into the incinerator. Okay, that's so suspicious I don't even need to play that suspicious clip. But in order to distract Phoenix, she draws his attention to a cracked urn with I am written on it. And apparently it has the spirit of the person who founded the Karain School of Channeling, Mystic Ami, sealed inside it. I am... Ami... meh, it's probably just a coincidence. But what isn't is what Phoenix finds in the incinerator. A piece of cloth that looks like it came from Maya's costume, with a tiny bit of blood on it. Huh. Returning to the detention center, Phoenix said that he suspects even before Maya began the channeling, she was drugged, and set up so that she would look like the real murderer. In return, Maya tells us that before the channeling began, she was playing ball with Pearl outside. In fact, she still might have been playing with it when the channeling began, and she's always hiding in the clothing box in the side room. Methinks Pearl might have something to do with this mystery after all. Returning to Karain Village, Phoenix runs into a very upset Lada, and chasing after her, Phoenix not only finds the ball in question outside the clothing box, with Lada having hidden inside it, but there's a small hole in the clothing box, about 8 inches off the ground, the same height as the height of the hole in the folding screen. Speaking of putting things together, Phoenix surmises that Pearl accidentally broke the sacred urn while playing ball in the winding way during the murder, and tried to glue it back together so no one would notice. She did lie, but she honestly thought that if Morgan found out, the mediums would make her leave the village. But really, how could you stay mad at that face? However, even with this new information, Phoenix is still at a dead end when he runs into Lada again. And from her, we get some information on Innie. She was actually hospitalized about a year ago. After Lada gives Phoenix the hospital's address, he goes there and we meet this really weird, creepy guy. He claims to be Dr. Hottie, the director of the Hottie Clinic, but apparently if the nurse's word is to be believed, he's just some crazy old guy who goes around pretending to be the director. And he's the only one we can talk to. Oh, the inhumanity indeed, Phoenix. Well, I say hospital, but the Hottie Clinic is really to treat patients when there isn't room for them in the bigger general hospital down the street. And 1 year ago, Innie was hospitalized after being severely burned in a... traffic accident? In fact, she was burned so badly her face was unrecognizable, and the doctors had to reconstruct her face from a picture she had of herself. The pieces are slowly starting to come together, it seems. Returning to Karain Village confirms what most of us already suspected. See, normally the position of master among the channelers goes to the eldest daughter in the family, and Morgan is Misty's older sister. But since she has very little spiritual power, the position went to Misty instead, and now Morgan wants to become the master herself. But enough about that, it's time to unlock Innie's secret. Apparently she was actually in the car with Mimi when she had the accident that killed her, and unable to save her sister, she had a good reason to try and murder Dr. Gray, since she believes he drugged her sister with sleeping pills. But that won't hold up in court without hard evidence, and she knows it. Apparently the whole Valley Girl thing was just an act. I bet she's not even a natural redhead! We then see Morgan getting taken away by the police? Huh? I guess she's under suspicion. Well, she leaves Pearl in charge, but she apparently has a bad feeling that Maya might be in danger and needs Phoenix. Phoenix hesitates to leave Pearl behind all by herself, but she insists that Maya needs him more than her. You're a good kid, Pearl. Maya's lucky to have you in her family. But there's still one last thing we need to take care of before the trial the next day. Mia's psyche locks. Yes, apparently Mia knows something about the real murderer, but she's keeping it secret to protect Morgan? Well, that's actually unexpected. See, if this scrap of burnt cloth is any indication, and the channeling chamber key was found in the incinerator, apparently someone changed Maya's clothes before the police arrived and burnt what she was wearing. And since Morgan was the only one taking care of her at that point, yeah, I'd say she's pretty suspicious. But Morgan has an alibi. She was with them while the murder was actually taking place. So she might have had a co-conspirator, namely, Eeny-Meeny. Nothing left to do now but to try and figure out at the trial the next day. Before the trial, however, Phoenix tells Pearl that she should really channel Mia for them. He says it's because he's not confident enough to do this without her, but truthfully, he doesn't want Pearl to see what's going to happen next. Sure enough, Morgan gets called to the stand, and she's already changing her story, saying that she was knocked out by Maya and can't recall where she was during the time she was unconscious. But apparently there is someone who can. I'll give you three guesses who, and the first two don't count. Eeny claims that Maya, as Mimi, came to her after knocking out Morgan, but Phoenix is soon able to disprove that. And when he does... Wait, I think I saw something there. Maybe it's just my imagination. Well, despite trying to tear her hat in half or smother herself with it the entire time, Phoenix breaks down Eeny's testimony brick by brick, figuring out that during the murder she knew things only she could have known if she was in the channeling chamber. But since, as we know, Pearl was repairing the urn in the winding way, there's no way she could have gone there that way. But recall the hole in the clothing basket. Phoenix soon deduces that she was hiding inside the basket, which had been placed behind the folding screen, probably by Morgan, and wearing a medium's costume so that she could masquerade as Maya Faye to kill Dr. Gray. So here's what really happened. Having been placed here while the two people in the channeling chamber had their eyes closed, Eeny crept out of the box and drugged Maya with a strong sleeping agent, stabbing Dr. Gray with the knife, thinking she'd killed him, and was about to put Maya into the box when the still-conscious Dr. Gray used the last of his strength to fire a single bullet, which passed through the screen and hit the box, but not anyone else, thankfully. But one thing still remains, the motive. At first, it looks like the judge has already made his ruling, but again, surprisingly, Francisca offers Phoenix the chance to pursue his line of questioning. If only because he still has the will to fight, and she wants to completely destroy him, as Daddy Dearest would have wanted. And yet, doing this still makes her more likable than her father was. Court reconvenes after a short recess, which I'll talk more about in the character section. We go back to the original accident 1 year ago. Eeny soon reveals that her sister's car was actually imported from the UK, and according to the article the fake doctor gave Phoenix, she opened the right side door to get out, which means she was actually in the driver's seat, even though she claimed her sister wouldn't let her drive. But what does this mean? Well, remember that after the accident, Eeny's face was apparently so badly burned that she was unrecognizable were it not for the picture she had on her? That's right. The person we thought was Eeny all this time was in fact Mimi, who had facial reconstruction surgery to look like her younger sister, Eeny, who was the one who actually died in the fire. This has suddenly become the plot of Pretty Face. Yes, apparently Mimi became her own sister to forget about her losses and start over after the malpractice incident. But unfortunately, Dr. Gray made the mistake of consulting her about contacting Mimi. But since she was still alive, that fact would have been discovered had the channeling actually happened. Well, there are still some unanswered questions, but it's pretty clear that Maya's not guilty here, despite Francisco whipping Phoenix into unconsciousness. And despite an ominous epilogue with Morgan saying that Pearl will one day get her chance to become the new master, this case is closed.